Hello to you. My name is Maria Kondzielska and this is Poland Daily Culture. This is the last episode of Tamara Łępicka. With me in the studio is Grzegorz Musioł, a person who probably knows the most about Tamara in Poland.
But not all, definitely not all.
But so much that I don't know so much about my own life as you know about Tamara. But so a main question about every life of every single person, especially about an artist, is was Tamara happy in her life? Was she fulfilled? And was she loved? Or was she lonely?
Well, it's a good question, though, because she, as everything in her life, was ambiguous. She had two persons in her, you know, the one who wanted revolution and the one who surrendered to most aristocratic manners as a lady, whatever. And other things also we've spoken about in previous parts of this meeting. But this was also the part of her ambiguity now. Was she happy? She was happy and unhappy because she was unhappy, first of all, because she was alone and she was not fulfilled as an artist. Her career, the being on the top, was just 10 years practically, well, 20 years, say, between 1922, 23 and 1940s. When she painted in America, she tried to find her new status as a painter because her portraits were rejected by the American audience in the 1940s. Nobody was interested in her paintings anymore, like portraits of these upper-class people in Paris in the 20s who cared for them anymore. But she painted still natures, beautiful still natures. She painted vegetables, beautiful vegetables, interiors of the hotel rooms, fantastic pictures, because she turned away from people. She said that American faces do not inspire her. On French in Parisian streets, she could read human history from almost every second face. In America, they always smile and keep their cocktails in their hands. That's what she said, you know. They are happy when they have their cocktails, you know. So this is all what I can read about lives from their faces. So she liked Americans, of course, quite a lot, but she was not serious about them as the possible objects of her paintings. So she turned towards vegetables, toward the chairs, windows with the light in it. Beautiful, beautiful pictures. I like them very much. But it meant, you know, the lack of people around her again. And she was in the 1940s, 50s, when she was rejected as an artist, she became a sociality. She was a lady of higher social circles in New York, in Los Angeles, whatever. She met Greta Garbo. She was a friend of this, of that. You know, she knew everybody. She was so rich.
So she knew everybody. She was rich. But was she happy?
She was not happy. Absolutely, she wasn't. She was not fulfilled as an artist. She knew she was forgotten, also in Europe. So it was such a surprise for her that she was rediscovered in 1970s, shortly before her death, by the student of fine arts, Alain Blondel, who found her album and suddenly he fell in love with her. And he made that exhibition, which was a sensation in Paris.
So we truly
suddenly she became famous, but it was too late. She was already a devastated emotionally person because she had very bad relationship with her daughter, with her granddaughters, as I said. She disinherited them, finally. And also she lost two people she loved. Definitely she lost them, forever. First great love of hers was Tadeusz, was her first husband, Tadeusz Łępicki, Polish aristocrat. She met, it was her teenage love. They met on a ball at Yusupov's palace in St. Petersburg, shortly before the revolution. Totally fell in love, both very beautiful young people, not just like in the romantic movie. And suddenly the revolution comes and everything is smashed to pieces, you know, like the whole life lays in ruin. He was arrested, he was taken to prison, she was then fighting for him, then emigration, then difficult life in Paris first years, and finally getting away different ways. She was going very, very strongly towards becoming an artist, fully developed, and it needed education, other things. And he was sort of loafer. In a way, she was a do-nothing.
As an aristocrat.
Because he was, as an aristocrat, yes. She was not accustomed to the work. Even more than that, he was not supposed to work because his family belonged to the Hunters Club in Warsaw. The highest aristocracy was grouped in Hunters Club in Warsaw, and one of the points of the rules of belonging to this club was that you are not supposed to work. if you work for your living, you are thrown out. So he said, I cannot work, he said, because they threw me out from the Hunters Club. So, of course, it's a joke. Of course, nobody did it seriously. But he really, well, finally he started working in the Paris.
And they didn't have children with Tadeusz.
They had a child. They had a Kizet, a daughter, one, who was practically brought up by her, by Tadeusz and by the grandmother, Malvina, who was with them in Paris. And she Tamara had no time to be a good mother for the daughter. She was accused for going to the clubs, you know, and then living a happy life, but it was not true. She went to Louvre to paint at night because she was experimenting with light on different times of a night, like early dawning and, you know, the light from the window and then lighting the different colors of the lampshades and finding, you know, the play of light on the surface of the certain paintings she chose for that night, with the blue light or with the yellow light or with the red light. Fascinating. That's why
a night meeting in Louvre.
That's why the portraits are so lively, because she found the secret of the light on the surface of the human body in different colors. She did experiment, hours and hours spent, and she had no time to bring up to make you know, good dinners for the family and then be a good wife. Marriage broke down finally after the alleged romance of hers with the writer, Italian writer Gabriele D'Annunzio, which press made a whole big riot about her visit to Gabriele D'Annunzio, who was very influential in Italy in 1920s. He was a friend of Benito Mussolini, and she cared on her good contacts, you know, to promote her arts. So she took his offer to paint his painting, and the press made a romance between them, and Tadeusz would not stand it any longer, because the journalist wrote, oh, here's the new mistress of Gabriele D'Annunzio, the Polish, beautiful Polish painter, used with him in embrace, you know, and other things. Of course, it was a friendly embrace, so they made it a sexual embrace out of it, and Tadeusz just couldn't stand it anymore.
And the other husband.
And the other husband was the elder man. He was much older than hers. She called him even a papi. So because he was a kind of a father for her, because she didn't have her own father. The father of the Pitski family, of Tamara's, left the family when she was only 3 years old. And she never spoke about him. He just went away. He just disappeared. He disappeared. Probably he went away with another woman. And for some reason, I don't know what reason, she didn't speak about it any time. So he was a kind of a father for her. And she was rather, in a childish way, bound to him than any sexual whatever. So it was a kind of a loneliness for the woman who...
was so attractive and beautiful.
Amorous and hot-blooded, you know.
So just back to her, just to wrap up, to say, and then at the very end of her life, she ends in Mexico.
Yes.
And what's about her loneliness there?
That's again the story told to me by Victor Contreras, when he sees her sitting on the terrace and looking ahead of her on the volcano, which is far away, is this silhouette of a volcano, of that famous Popocatépetl. And she looks at this volcano and she just motionlessly, and she moves her lips, and he comes closer and he listens that she speaks to herself, alone, alone, alone.
Alone, alone, alone. And just to know that Tamara, at the end of her life, becomes, her ashes were put to the volcano. So she is a part of this huge mountain right now, which combines the energy and the ambiguity that she had also in her life. And that is why you have to read the story about Tamara Wimpicka. And thank you very much for being with us.